Hello and welcome to the latest edition of the SWN podcast. I'm your host, as always, Billy, and I am back with another new face in Scottish wrestling, someone who you may have seen on the interweb, on Twitter, because they're starting to make waves right now, making their debut quite recently. I'm joined by the one and only Nicole Jasmin. Welcome to the show.
Hello, guys. Good to
have you on. I'm excited for this, because like I said, we kind of half-arranged this before you even made your debut, because really, I've seen the groundswell support for you online when it comes to your journey, which we'll get into when we're speaking, I'm sure. But it's just nice to see just this, all this support and love into your wrestling journey. So I wouldn't be a half decent podcaster if I thought I'm going to need to find out more about Nicole Jasmin and find out maybe why people are so in love with you, and hopefully in the next however long hour or so we might find out. First question is always the cliche, though. It's the cliche podcast question. You'll probably ask this a million other times now after this. But how did you get into pro wrestling? So what was the moment watching it that got you hooked on pro wrestling?
I've always, same as everyone else, I've always been a wrestling fan, always watched it. But when I was about 10, 11, I always just watched the Divas. So it was always like Mickey James, Melina, Trish, Kelly, all that kind of diva era. And I didn't ever think I would ever be into wrestling. Like, I was always quite this girly girl. Like, I was a cheerleader, a gymnast. Like, didn't think anything of it. Just loved watching wrestling. Just loved the Divas. Like, I thought every time I watched them, I was hooked. And then I think it was, I used to go to like WWE shows with my wee cousin, Unbury Head, and I loved it. Like, I'd love seeing the Divas and I love seeing the guys. And I was like, I quite like this. But at the time, like, I was into professional like gymnastics. I was into cheer. Like, I was doing 3-4 times a week, like gymnastics and professional cheerleading, doing competitions and stuff. And like, my friends were really girly at the time. So I kind of like took a step back, didn't really think much of it. And then I think it was like 2016, I'd seen an advertisement for a BCW show, and Angelina Love was on it. So of course I was like, I need to be there. So me and my cousin headed down, and then from then on we were always like at the family shows. Didn't really know anything of like the over 18 scene or like ICW and stuff, didn't really know about that much. And also I didn't really know where to go and train, because I'd always like, I'd set my heart after I'd seen the Divas, I was like, I need to do this, like I need to get into it. And then I think it was like a Pro Wrestling Elite show, and I was walking out the door and someone handed me an Asylum leaflet, and I'd had a wee look, went online, and I'd seen that they were like taking an intake in, and this was 2016 and 17, and I just signed up. That was it, like I was going. And I'd started from then on. When I'd signed up, I'd went to like ICW shows just myself. I'd go stand at the back myself and just watch the show. And I was so like, I was hooked when I seen like the likes of Viper and Kim, they were on, Viper and Kaylee, sorry, were on the show. And I was just like, I need to do this. And then like a few months later, I was at the Asylum. And from then on, that's me, being there.
So we'll wind it right back to the start then. So Divas is what you're into, the Diva time with the Mickey. I mean, the ones you mentioned, maybe bar Kelly for in-ring stuff, but the rest of them were all like really good wrestlers, but Kelly Kelly was a really great character, so not to dismiss dismiss our wrestling in itself. So right about that time, I suppose, for old folk like myself, we were like, oh, wrestling wasn't taken as seriously for women, but was that something you gravitated towards? Was it just because it was these cool women doing these amazing things? Or
I always see cool women and I was like, I'd love to do that. Like, and then so as time went on, I gradually started to look up to the guys and be like, they're not just entertaining everyone, they've actually put their bodies through this. And then I started to like just have this love for them. But I think what brought me into the wrestling and kind of got me hooked instantly was the Divas, for definite. And just seeing from like how they started to now, like how much of a change there's been. Like, it's not just entertaining, but it's entertaining and it's wrestling, and like the girls are as good as the guys, basically. But that's definitely what got me hooked, was definitely the Divas.
So as far as the guys then, so who was your kind of favourite trend about then?
So guy-wise, I think I was loved Randy Orton, CM Punk as well, definitely The Undertaker and Triple H. Like, it was all kind of the main ones that I liked. And then just from then on, like, it was always just, I liked them and then I liked the Divas. But then I started to like grow a lot more, like love for them because I seen what they were doing, but it was definitely those couple that instantly got me hooked as well.
It must be cool, like going, I know for myself, going to your first live WWE show. Yeah. I mean, mine was like in Aberdeen, so it was like a smaller venue in comparison to Brayhead. But do you remember, what were your memories of that first couple of shows at Brayhead?
It was just the atmosphere and actually seeing it in person instead of over like from the TV and like DVDs and stuff. Like, it was just such a different experience. And I think from then on, like every time I seen it advertised, I was like, we need to go. And me and my cousin would book the tickets and we'd go down and stuff. And it was definitely from then on, I just knew that I wanted to be in that ring. And when I got older, I was definitely like, right, I need to try and get going. Like, I need to get the ball rolling. Because I've always had like a sports background. So I knew that I'd be all right with it. But when I got into wrestling, I knew that it wasn't just like a sports background I needed. It was definitely physically challenging and had to push forward.
But that's the weird thing, going to the live shows, because it doesn't matter where you sit, because, well, last Aberdeen one, I was like right at the back, which ACC is not the biggest venue anyway, but going right to the back, and you could just about see everything, but it was still the coolest thing ever, because it was, I think, like, AJ Styles, Dean Ambrose was the main event of my last one I went to.
There's always, like everywhere, like in the hydro as well, like everywhere you can sit, there's always a good seat, and you get the same atmosphere as being down front or being up the back.
The first time I went to the Hydro was last year. So I'm 31 now, and the first time I went to the Hydro was last year for McFly, and I couldn't believe how like well spaced out it was. And when you look at the outside, it looks humongous. It looks like if you're right at the back, you'll see nothing. But like you're saying, if you're right at the back, you're gonna get a great view anyway. And it's amazing. I was like intimidated by it because, you know, I'm up in the sticks, so a big city is intimidating anyway. But to go down to the Hydro, think, oh my god, this is. I've traveled too far. I need to go back to a farm, and there it is. It's like, holy shit. But yeah, so with that, you said you got a sports background, and so you said gymnastics, cheerleading. So you've definitely, by signs of it, then you've definitely got the kind of, I suppose, footwork dexterity kind of thing going on.
Yeah,
rhythm.
I had a wee bit of background in that, but once I got into wrestling, I was like, didn't think as much. Like, didn't think I was great at it. So I've like definitely had a couple of intakes for the asylum. I've done three. So I think my first one was very challenging. Didn't really think, because it was that like jumping from one sport into this deep end. I just thought like, I can't do this anymore. Like, is it for me kind of thing? And then I kind of took a wee step back, didn't think anything of it. And then the year later, I went back, got through, and then I just felt like this isn't for me anymore. Just gave up for a couple of months. Still went to the gym, still hit it hard. And I think I was quite down on myself. I was like, I really want to get back into this, but how did I do it? So I just kind of grafted away in the gym and stuff. And then I think it was 2019. I just knew I had to get back and do it. I was like, if I don't do it this time, when am I going to do it kind of thing? Jump back to the asylum, and that's me being there since and debuted.
Well, sorry, was it just because I know going through like your social media and that you're very open about your, not just like your workouts as well, because you show your body progress and all that kind of stuff, which is really heartwarming. It's really great to see and see your progress, where you come from and where you're going. But you're also very open about your mental health as well. So you've spoken about setbacks and stuff like that before. But so we'll go back to the first intake. We won't like go into the nitty-gritty details of things and the hows and whys. We don't need to do that, because we'll try and keep it as positive as we can. So that first one, you went to BCW a couple of times, you went to some family shows, and you got your first intake on GPWA. Who were your first trainers then? Was it
Jester? First were the likes of Jester, Lionheart, BT Gun, Red Lightning, Wolfgang at the time. And the first day I walked in, it was all them in a line. And that kind of like sent me back. I was like, I've watched these guys for a couple of months. I know how good they are. And I was just like, I need to try and make them like me and want to be able to train me and know that I'm going to be good enough. So seeing that was quite daunting. And I was just like, can I go back out the door kind of thing? But stuck in it. And then, just from there. They were really great coaches. They always gave me really good advice. just like hearing feedback from them, like on wee things that they were like, oh, that's really good, like not a lot of people can do that kind of thing, like definitely made me want to keep pushing. But obviously at that time, I just, my mindset wasn't in it to have continued now. And I think if I'd continued from then, I wouldn't have been here now. Like, I think I would have been up, like, I wouldn't have gave it up. Like, I wouldn't have continued on.
Mm-hmm. So you, like, yeah, like, at least you had the maturity to kind of go, right, I'm not ready for this. I need to kind of take a step back and I'll come back again. And like you're saying, the worst thing you could have done was just plow ahead, and that could have just been all sorts of, because if you had another setback after that, then that could have been a more harsher thing. And yeah, it's how old were you when that your first intake then was?
I think my first intake, so that was 2017. So I would have been about, oh, my maths isn't great, sorry. Right. So I'm 25 just now, so it would have been,
oh god, my maths has failed me as well.
Yeah, my maths isn't. I passed that in school, but
25, so born 97, so 17-ish.
Yeah.
Okay, so yeah, it's 17 to work out, right, no, this isn't for me just now, but you'll come back to it. Did you continue to watch wrestling after that?
I continued to watch it, loved it, but I think every time that I'd seen a women's match, I was like, I really want to do this, and I think it pushed me even further. But I still watched wrestling, even though I wasn't training, still went to the gym's heart, like, as much as I could, and then I was just like, I need to get back into this. And then the second time round, I think just, I'm very open about my mental health, folks speak about it all the time, if it helps me, it's going to help others as well. And then during that time, I just, mental health wasn't great, and my mindset wasn't exactly all there as well, and then took time off again. And then I just thought, like, this is the last time, if I can't do it now, that's me, like, I'll be fine, like, as long as I've tried. And then just, I think, something instantly clicked, and that was me ever since.
So we'll definitely get into your debut in a little bit. So we're still just laying the groundwork a little bit more. So during that hiatus then of you training, when you were watching it, like you said, you watched the women's and your women wrestling, you were like, oh, that needs to be me. Did you find after your first lot of intake and you took that break, you were watching wrestling more as an analytical kind of watching all the movements?
I think I was definitely watching it a lot more, because I knew, like, what was kind of, if I'd put in the work, what was ahead of me kind of thing. But when I was watching as well, I was getting obviously quite down. I was like, I wish I could have done this. And I think that's maybe what's pushed me now to just go for it. But I'm just glad I've stuck in and not actually gave up.
Must have been just after your second intake. I think we bumped into each other once. But I'm a shite person in real life. I'm really not that great with speaking to anyone. But I think it was the Aberdeen show for ICW. But yeah, I was like, just much like you said, I'll go to a show on your own. I was in the back just like hoping nobody spoke to me. So you're fairly traveled to get to the wrestling shows as well. So is there any particular that have been, has just been Scotland you've been based, or have you headed down south? What's your kind of routine?
I've been mostly Scotland, but there was one ICW show I travelled down for, and it was the Newcastle one. I'm not sure what year that was, but I went down for that, and it was really good. Loved it. It was just such a different atmosphere from being in the Scottish shows. But that's mainly it, just here, Newcastle, and some TNT shows as well in Liverpool. Like, they're awesome. Like, really good. It's definitely a promotion that I would like to, hopefully in the near future, work for. But I've been down to Liverpool as well, so that's just for TNT though.
So you got the final intake. Was it that when you were starting to do like some bits and pieces, like the crew of shows, that was that during the second?
I didn't start doing crew until I was 2019, when I passed and got to make the main program. But before that, like, I was always massive fan of Scottish wrestling. I'd always try and get to the shows as much as possible. And then when I started to do crew, I was like, it was such a different, like, seeing everything. I was just like, this is like, I had to be very professional, and like seeing people I would see on the TV and stuff, like backstage, and I was memorized. I was like, I like this. And then just seeing, like, getting to know them and getting to like speak to them and stuff, like, it was great. And even till this day, like, I could walk past like someone that maybe they've brought in like to do the show, and I'm just like memorized because I'm always going to be a fan.
Yeah, I've done crew, like I did crew once for Rock and Wrestle up in Inverness, and wasn't even out of Strathpeffer of all places, so way further north. And it's weird when you go the other side of the barrier, even though you're not actually wrestling. Like you're saying, it's a totally different experience. You're like, you've got to think of two things. One, you've got to watch the show. Maybe try and take something away from it, and then go, please, nobody jump. Please, nobody jump the barrier, please. I'd rather you don't do that. So who was the first person in your professional face you were walking up to and going, oh my God, I need to be a grown-up here?
I think it was the first time that I was backstage and I bumped into Viper and Kaylee, and I was just like, because I'd always watched them, always loved them. Kaylee would come into training sometimes and help us out, and even like the first time she walked into training, I was shocked because like I've always like idolized her, like I just loved what she's done in the ring. But then seeing them backstage, I was like shocked. But now I'm just like, when I see people now, I'm just like, hello, like trying to make conversation. But back then, because I was like that transition from a fan to like part of the crew, I was memorized, like just seeing people that I'd watched and like idolized.
It's amazing. It's like for myself, I was just so we kind of have the same sort of different experiences, because now you're actually doing the wrestling. But Drew was the first one that I, because again, these Rock and Wrestle shows, but I didn't even know he's on the show. I'd picked up, I guess, Rob Terry, I think, who broke my Corsa, my Clio, because you've seen the size of him. My Clio was never the same after that. And then went upstairs, and there was Drew just hanging about with his soon-to-be wife. And I was like, what are you doing here? It's just it doesn't matter.
You've seen them.
You shouldn't. No, this isn't. No, you're supposed to be on the telly.
Yeah, you're supposed to be on the telly. You should be here. And then I realized it's them.
You must have got a lot, because you do have a good swipe of a Kaylee Ray. Was that, did you ever find that when you were, because I know people kind of compare you to Kaylee. How do you find that?
I always get that, like I'm just like, I don't look anything like Kaylee. I'm like, I don't wrestle like her, she's unreal. Like, she is like, I definitely idolize her. Some people said that like I look a wee bit like her. I'm just like, oh. Like I always get dead like flushed. I'm like, I can't, like I don't, because she's like, in my eyes, she's amazing, and I'm just like, I'm nothing.
Absolutely not. You've wrestled. You're a professional now, I'm assuming. I'm assuming you got paid. So I'm assuming you're a professional at this point. But yeah, so we got to the final. Drop something there. So we got to the final intake. You passed. Was that just the best feeling in life? What was your kind of feeling finally passing?
I just, like, I went home and I cried because I was like, I can't believe it's actually, like, I've managed this. So the person, like, so Stevie Boy that done our exam thing. And he like got us in the ring, and he would like tell us to go over like sequences we've done and like go over everything we've learned in those three intakes. And then at the end, he would like take us into a wee room and be like, this is what I think you should do, and this is where I think like you should go, or maybe like if we're taking you, like we'll tell you. So I went into the room and I was just like, I knew I'm getting bad news. Like, I don't know why, I just always have this feeling that it's bad. Went in and Stevie was like, you don't need to look so nervous. He was like, you're coming to the main class. And I was just like, I don't think it kicked in until I got home. And I don't, like, I can remember after it being like, right, I need to eat healthy now. So I went into Krispy Kreme in Central Station, bought these two Krispy Kremes and went on the train. Like, I ate one on the train and then ate one when I got home. And I think when I was eating, I was just sobbing. I was like, I can't believe I've done this. Like, I'm going into this main class. So I kind of, then I think I was like, the realisation of this is it. Like, I need to work hard, because now I'm in the main program and there's going to be a lot more opportunities now. And then obviously like a couple of months later, COVID hit and that was us locked down.
That's where I was kind of wondering the timeline was, but you said late 2019, of course, yeah. March 2020 arrives, COVID arrives. So after all that hard work, you finally made it. You finally got through the initial intake. The wrestling world stops entirely. So how did you cope during that, either initial lockdown or just lockdown in general?
Lockdown, I think I was obviously, like everybody, did struggle a lot, just not being able to see anyone, not being able to go and train, not being able to go to the gym and stuff, but I managed to keep quite good in comparison to maybe what I would have been like a couple of years before. Managed to still work out, done some online seminars with Andy Wild. Like, he was fantastic during that time. Always managed to get his own students at FPWA and us outside of FPWA. Like, he always managed to get like great wee like video stuff and like webinars and stuff, and like, it was really good. Like, definitely has helped me a lot, and I've took some information on board as well. But I definitely done all right during lockdown. It was a struggle, but I managed to keep working out, doing like in the garden and stuff, and garden workouts and in my room and stuff. Like, definitely, I think a lot of the stuff I learned in lockdown I've took on for wrestling, and definitely came back a lot stronger.
Yeah, it's great to see like Andy Wild and looking sharp as well. Mm-hmm. And there's a lot of places that were offering. It's weird to think maybe, well, before you probably started watching wrestling, would be mm-hmm. a lot harder for that to happen. You would have had to. You're either going to a training seminar or you weren't. That was pretty much the two options. Mm-hmm. But now we're in the advent of technology where, yeah, they've got Zoom and we've got all this kind of webinar stuff that you can still learn. So I know Andy had quite a lot of people on, including Viper as well, Piper mm-hmm. Niven, Dewdrop. Yeah. You've got to have all three names in there somewhere mm-hmm. so someone knows who is. Was there any particular seminar webinar that was maybe enriching that you didn't think would be when you went into it?
I didn't really get on. It's like, I didn't get to go on. I just got to see videos of it. But definitely the one that caught my eye was obviously Viper and Dewdrop. So we got a wee video back from it, like a recording, if you couldn't make it. And like just our information on like women's wrestling and stuff. Like, it was great to take on board as a obviously new upcoming Scottish wrestler. Like, it was great to hear her information, the stuff that she does and stuff, but it was definitely very good. I really enjoyed it, and I've took a lot of information that I learned through it on board.
So after you got your Krispy Kreme, after you've had your sob and you're definitely going into the main class, was that the point where you thought, right, I need to start thinking of a little bit of a character and you start thinking about ring gear? Or were you one of those people that drew their ring gear like when you were younger?
I think I've always been that one that always knew like what I wanted my ring gear to be like. I always knew it. I kind of always knew like my moveset and stuff, and like what I as a character wanted to be. I'd always had that set in the back of my head, like whether I was wrestling or not, it was always there. And then I think once I got put in main class, that was it. I was like, I need to hit the gym hard, I need to work hard so I can get this, and this is the designs I want, this is what I want to do in the ring. And since then I've just been very like creative, like my wee brain just goes and that's it.
So back to watchings of wrestling. So I keep starting these things with, now you're going to be a wrestler. Now you're going to be a wrestler at this point. What was your kind of watching habits from that point onwards? Was it still WWE, or did you go into AEW? Did you search for things like Shimmer? What was your kind of?
I just watched Pro Wrestling Eve, mainly because that's always women based. I always watched ICW on the network, and I think it was just WWE. I think it was just a bit of everything. And then I started to like didn't really watch much of AEW, and then I'd seen maybe a wee good like stuff online, and gave it a wee watch, and then I've been hooked since. Like, I love Britt. She's great. I think she's amazing. But just a wee bit of everything I think I watched.
And the internet dipped just as you said the name of the person there. Who was it that you watched in AEW that you like?
Britt Baker.
There we go. Mm-hmm. That's just funny. Just it literally dipped just as you said the name. I was like, oh no, yeah. I don't know who it is. Britt Baker. So when it comes to your style then, as Nicole Jasmin's wrestling style, is there anyone in particular that you kind of patterned some bits and pieces off of? What would you kind of say it would be?
I think my style is very Melina-ish. I think like the stuff she does, like being the flexible, the flippy stuff, like that's kind of my style, and that's what I've based my moveset on. And obviously growing up, like Melina's, I've always idolised Melina as well. That's partly reason as well for getting into wrestling. And I think my moveset is very her. And I'm quite glad like I've managed to find stuff that is quite different, but it's also me as well.
That's the thing, because I mean, I suppose there's lots of women's wrestlers now in Scotland, but there's still not enough to maybe have some like copycats. Everyone's got a different thing going on. You've got things like like Ruby Roberts is like this kind of goth alternative kind of chick, and then you got Emily Hayden, who's like a bit mental, but she's got this like online presence and Twitch and all that kind of stuff. So, and then Ashley Vega, of course, the diva. So it's great that that there's still there's enough wrestlers to put on shows, but there's still enough wiggle room that you can do and play about with your character and have a little bit of a niche somewhere for it. We do have a question from Pro 2 Wrestling, which is very similar to what I've just asked. So I apologize, Logan, for doing that. But it's about, what's your inspiration for your moveset, which you kind of just answered, and your ring gear general gimmick was the other one. So your ring gear. So it's a gold, blue,
half and half.
So what was your inspiration behind that?
My inspiration was in it. So I used to, obviously I've got a dancing background, and I used to have a costume the exact same, and it was always the lucky costume. I think it was one that won me first in a dance competition, so I've always kind of stuck by it. And I think I wanted gold as my first gear, but then I also wanted blue. But I like kind of designed this thing in my room where I was like, right, I'll have half and half. And then I went on, couldn't find anywhere that would have done it for me. And then I found like this design website and this girl that like makes ring gear. And I sent her over and she was like, I can get that made for you. And then she sent it back, and that's when I first got it. I was amazed because I just didn't know what colour to go for, and I just thought, you know what, I'll be different and go half and half. What's the worst it can do? Hopefully it looks nice, and it does. So I'm quite glad about that.
Is that when that became like wrestling? You're actually a wrestler now. You've got your gear and all that. Was that the moment you open up and it was like,
ah. When I first got my gear, I was like, it was actually happening. Like, I'm kind of on the way to it happening. Still to this day I'm in denial. I'm like, am I wrestling? Like, am I doing wrestling? But yeah, it's definitely good to know that that's happened.
Just looking at the questions again, David Brown pretty much answered yours as well. He says, who are your influences when it comes to your in-ring moveset? So again, that's another one we've kind of answered as we go along. We'll still shout out the people that have asked the questions, even if though we've answered them. Right, so let's get to the debut then. That's the big thing. So Iron Girders kind of started up in the wake of the pandemic. Iron Girders were kind of offering a space for wrestlers to get a bit of in-ring training and gym work and all that kind of stuff, and PT and all that kind of thing. And they started announcing shows. So when were you aware you were going to be making your debut?
So I only found out three weeks before I debuted. Didn't think anything of it. Had always went to help for the first couple of shows, and I was always in the Iron Girders training away at the gym and in the ring and stuff, but didn't ever think it, was always just happy to be there, was always just happy to work out, didn't ever think that was going to be my debut for a place that like I idolise so much, and Wolfgang's helped me a lot, like he's always given me really good feedback, and he's always went above and beyond for his students that he trains, but I only found out 3 weeks before I debuted, and I was shocked, I got told that, yeah, you're going to be in the Girders Gauntlet. And I think those 3 weeks were so daunting. I was excited, but I was nervous. So I was like, I'm a mixture of everything.
I was going to say, are you one of the people that if you've got 3 weeks, you're going to worry about all things that can go wrong in that 3 weeks? Would you have been maybe better prepared if you were told a couple of days beforehand so you can't worry about it?
I've always been obviously I did performing before I'd got into wrestling, so I was all right with the nerves, but I think it was the realisation that you're going to be in front of a crowd, you're going to be in a wrestling ring, doing what you've loved. And then I think that was kind of all hitting me, but I wasn't nervous until the day of. I got to Girders and I was speaking to a few of the other wrestlers, and then that was it, the realisation hit. And just before I walked through the curtain, I was like, this is happening. And then when I got out, just seeing the crowd and stuff, the cheer. Before it, I was personally I'm not getting this cheer. They don't know me. I'm just a new kid in the scene. It's going to be dead. And then I walked out and I just, so surreal.
Yeah, it was just that moment. Yeah, literally you're standing next to the wrestlers going, oh no, I'm one of you guys. Oh no.
Yeah, I was so used to being just helping out at the shows or just doing the merch. And then I was I'm one of them now. I need to do this. But it was great. I would honestly love to go back and do it again, but unfortunately I can't debut again.
You only get one debut. And I was seeing the clips come up on YouTube, Twitter, and I was to be honest, like I mean, you come into a first match, if you watch wrestling for, unfortunately, for as long as I have, you can see if someone new and they're not quite like ready, or at least they're not quite confident. But I was watching these clips. I mean, they're only like 10-second clips, so I don't know what happened in between that time. You could have had an absolute meltdown. But during those 10 seconds or so that I saw, I was like, Christ, she's really good, kind of thing. She was like, everything was ripped so assured, and looked like this wasn't your first rodeo. Do you remember what happened during the match, or is it one of those times where you kind of switched off and you woke up afterwards?
I can actually remember it. So I thought I was going to shut down in the match, because I'm always quite a nervous person. Luckily that's dying off, because after the debut, I've just been like, it's been so confident since then. But I think it was just walking in, like getting into the ring, I kind of had a wee bit of a bump, a wee bit of an accident, but it wasn't anything bad. I just overtimed jumping in the ring, and that was it. And then once I'd obviously got in the ring, I met Shimonee, which he's having a bit of tittle-tattle on Twitter back and forward to me. So I was like, I'm going to meet him in the ring, see what he's got to say wrestling-wise. And then, everything went smoothly. The moves we put in went great. And then I think I would have won it if Anastasia didn't bit me off, but...
Yeah. But I mean, one of the bits I saw was you doing like the handspring elbow, which is a very difficult move to make look good. But I suppose that would be something that you're pretty confident in doing if you've been doing gymnastics and cheerleading. Is that something that you really wanted to have in your moveset?
I'd said on the day, even before, like a couple of days before, that's what I'd set out to do in my moveset, because I knew I could do it comfortably. Like I knew it was going to be put on and I'd look good. So I'd obviously put that in, because I knew that that's an influence by me as well, because that's obviously my background, and I wanted to influence what I'd done before into what I'm doing now and incorporate into something that I'm like, I love. So doing that, like, I just thought I had to add that. That's going to make me look good, and I'm confident doing it. Doing that, I'd done that, and I think my sister, because she was there, she was like, that was great. Like, where did you get out of that?
So speaking, you said you had the cheers and you thought they weren't for you, but like you say, what I've noticed, especially on Twitter, and that this whole supporter community that are so behind you and your wrestling journey, do you find that quite, I don't know, intimidating, or you just quite, do you find it amazing that after the show people are asking for pictures with you? And
honestly, still to this day, like, I'm still like a wee bit in shock. I'm like, people actually want to come over and like get my signature and get a photo with me. Like, even before I started wrestling, or even before I debuted, there was like people coming up to me, like ICW and like at the other Gudder shows, and they were just like, can I get a photo with you? Can I get your signature? But I hadn't debuted yet. And even then, I was just like, no, what? Like, I was very laid back about it. I was like, no, you don't need my signature, like, kind of thing. And they were just like, no, we want your signature, we want a photo with you. So I think even before I debuted, like, had quite a bit of support. And then after I debuted, like, everything just kind of went mental. Like, my Twitter, Facebook, all my social medias, like, everybody was just like, I can't believe you've done it, like, I knew you would, but I just didn't think I'd ever do it.
So we've got a bunch of questions, but we'll try and get through them, because like I said, we've got so many, which is always good when it comes to this kind of episode, because especially if you're brand new, you maybe have one or two matches, there's not a lot of wiggle room for me to speak about unless I try to delve into what your favorite TV shows are, which, you know, is fine most of the time, but it can be a bit weird if it's like, I've got nothing else to speak to you about. What do you like on telly? But we've got loads of them, so we'll just start with Westy. So we've got Westy asking, what's a normal day like in terms of wrestling training?
Normal day is just arrive at the asylum before the time that we'd probably train from. So my training is 6 to 8. So I'd get to the asylum about 5:55, 5:50. Get in, get changed, get a wee bit warmed up, get stretching, and then just get in the ring, and that's it from like the session. And then after it, we'd maybe do some matches and stuff, and then just different sequences. So that's basically what I do in the day, like training's like.
So initially when we were setting this up, of course, you were doing 2 days a week, and then you moved to 3. So was it just after that first match, you're like, right, no, I need another couple hours just to rev up, and I'm ready for this?
So I was originally just the one class a week, and I would always try and get to the gym at the weekends or try and be in classes, and then I got put into the women's class on a Wednesday, And then I was like, I think I need a wee bit more training after my debut. So that's when I started doing the Tuesday as well. And it was optional that you could do it as well to get more training time from the coaches. So I think definitely taking on 3 days a week is going to help me in the long run. I just love training. Just love being in the asylum. So to get 3 days, is, I'm really glad about it.
I mean, I suppose, like you're saying, with your experience in a sport background, you'll be impacting your body so often. How are you finding like moving up an extra day? Are you able to take the bumps?
I think just because I've always had a sporting background, I've been all right. I think the first time I did take bumps, like I was a bit blown away. I was like, right, I can't do this. But I try and recover well. When I'm obviously after training, I try and do as much as I can for my body to feel fine. But definitely taking on the extra day has been perfectly fine.
Excellent. Oh, to be young. That probably helps as well. Let's see what we've got here. I'm just trying to think ones that are a bit more. We've got Alan. Alan at Big F and Tree on Twitter. When you're kicking people's heads off, are you thinking about that woman with the piece in tuna?
Yeah. So that's a funny story behind this. So we were going down to watch a wrestling show in Liverpool. It was by TNT, and it was the 7 o'clock train, and we were on it at like 10 to 7. And I'm not a massive fan of tuna, and they all know that, the group that was with us. And there was a woman sitting behind me, and the train was just about to leave, and she opened the tuna sandwich. And I just remember looking at Alan and the two other girls that was with us. So ever since then, like, he always brings this up. I just looked like I wanted to, like, roundhouse kick her, because I was like, she's sitting right behind me, and I could just, the full journey was horrible.
No, it's a bold move with tuna sandwich in a train. I mean, I like a tuna sandwich, but yeah, not in a train. That's a dick move, really.
Yeah, it was very early as well, so I was just like, no.
In the morning, was it? Yeah, no, that's wrong. No, that's a lunchtime sandwich if you're going to have it anytime. Oh, yeah, that's fair. You can, that's deserving of a roundhouse. He's also asked, which will kind of link to a question we'll ask near the end, but you've got the main event at WrestleMania. Who would you rather face, Naomi or Melina?
I think Melina. I love Naomi. She's also one of my other favourites. But growing up, and the first person that instantly had me hooked was Melina. So I definitely would choose Melina. I popped when she came back this year at the Rumble. And I honestly, I screamed the house down, because that's how much, like, I just love her. But I would definitely pick Melina.
Like, I was about to ask that, yeah. How you felt when she made a return. Was it number two or three or something like that? And I was gone before you knew it, but still, it's the moment.
It was still amazing to see her return, but I've marked out for her. Like, I love her.
Right, let's see what else we've got. All those ICW ones, we'll get that in a bit. Kwaku has asked, what's the best elbow drop you've ever seen?
Kwakus.
I think I've half heard about this. Was this a bed in a hotel room?
Yeah.
He also asked me to show you this. He said it would make sense. Let's see. I don't need to find it, because I'm old with technology.
Yeah, I get it.
Further explanation on that?
So there's a joke behind it. We basically just went into a shop, and there was a can of Pink Monster, and I decided to turn around and shout it across the shop to Kwaku. So ever since then, whenever we meet, he's like, yeah.
That's fine. So that's my phone responsibility's gone. That can go away. So what else we've got here? We've got Suzanne. Suzanne Russ asking, who do you think has the best entrance music in wrestling currently?
Oh, that's hard. If you'd have said maybe back in the day, I'd probably have said Melina, because I loved her paparazzi entrance. Just now, I think, that's hard. There's a couple of people, and I'm...
Right, throw out a few. You don't have to, yeah. I won't set you on one.
I would say right now, I love Brits. I love her music. I also love Edge's and Rhea Ripley's. So I think that's the three I'm going to go for.
So the other side, the new one that he's using are just Metalingus in general. Metalingus is still, I've got, you know, it's weird that this Judgment Day things kind of went a bit awry already, but the fact that we might get Metalingus back, I'm okay with that as a trade, because it's the best wrestling theme, especially when you heard it come back at the Rumble when Edge returned. Like, oh, that's the best. Right, what else we got here? We got Maxwell Miller. He asked, who do you want to rival with? So who do you see as a good feud?
Right now, there's a few girls that I want to have a rival down with. The likes of Ellie Armstrong. She's obviously a fellow GPW trainee. And she's a hard-hitting girl. Would love to take her on. Would love to have a bit of a rival with her. Anastasia as well. I'd love to get her back because she kicked me in the face and I'm not letting it go easy. And I think like Ashley Vega as well. Like I love everything that she's doing right now. She's went from being this like girl like wrestles to this absolute diva. Like I love it. I just think women in Scottish wrestling, I'd love to have a rival with Scottish the girls in Scottish wrestling, but that's my main three.
No, I like when you're online, you're just like, yeah, you're pretty much just asking for a fight now that you've had your first show under your belt, first match under your belt. You're just like, right, who's next? Well, for a scrap. So we've got Fee asking, Manic Mania Fee, who's a very big fan of yours. I've noticed well behind your journey. Is there anyone in ICW you really want to beat up? And if yeah, who?
So there, I think I would love to just go through the women's division in ICW. Would love, obviously I've got a match in July with Miss Molly Spartan. I'm excited for that. So that's obviously one of my dream matches. I'd love to have a match at ICW, maybe with Ellie Armstrong again. She's hard hitting, she's another asylum girl. Moxie Malone as well. I like just watching them two like wrestle. I'm just like, oh, I might beat this up. And I think guy-wise, Shumini. I'd love to wrestle him like on a one-on-one. Or Thatcher Wright, he deserves a kick.
Aye, definitely. He deserves a boot by everyone.
So, yeah.
Well, I mean, if you're good into the kicking, I could, like yourself and Ian Skinner probably could have something a bit hard-hitting and just sear between the two years. But you mentioned Molly Spartan, which is a great segue. So you do have your second match scheduled for July, July 22nd for Community Pro Wrestling.
Yeah.
In it's Govan. That's going to be that show. And so, yeah, well, I ask everyone who's wrestled at Govan because I'm fascinated by the crowd because it's just the most wildest crowd I've ever seen. Past an ICW still. So what are your thoughts? What are your hopes? How are you feeling about that next match and debuting at Community Pro?
Very excited for it. I know it's going to be a tough match because I know how hard Molly hits. But I just know that I'm going to go in there and just hit back as hard as she's going to give it to me. Really looking forward to the atmosphere of the Govan crowds because I've been at every show like since they started. I've been there either helping or on merch. But to actually be in the ring and see how it is from that point of view, I'm just looking forward to seeing like how the crowd's going to react and stuff. So I'm looking forward to it.
I mean, your debut was in a battle royal, which is great. It's a great experience. But I suppose there's something a lot more, I don't know, nerve wracking, maybe getting your first singles match again in front of a Govan crowd as well. So are you feeling the pressure or are you just still riding on that confidence here, your first match?
I'm riding on that confidence. I know when I get on the day, like I'll probably be a bit nervous, but right now I'm just like, I'm excited. I'm just looking forward to getting into the match and hopefully getting the win.
Excellent. So we've got more future stuff. So we've got Pro 2 Wrestling also asking where we'll be seeing you next. So we kind of mentioned that Community Pro.
But I can't say until it's announced. But that's in England.
Oh, right. Yeah. So you're making already crossing the border.
Yeah, crossing the border.
Fine. So yeah, we'll find out in the coming weeks, I'm sure. like I said before, I'm not a journalist, so I'm not gonna be pressured. Make people go, tell me now, where are you going? So you've got plenty of things on the horizon, and like I said, you're putting yourself out there as well, and willing to just wrestle. Mm-hmm. Gaz Williams also asked on the back of that, what wrestling promotions do you want to appear on?
So I've got a few in Scotland. Definitely, obviously, want to break into the England scene, which is obviously happening. But I think my main ones are the likes of Insane Championship Wrestling. Always been a fan, always loved them. Would love to wrestle in front of them, like in front of a crowd. Wrestling's been Scotland, coming through, obviously, the Asylum. Like, that was my main one that I wanted. The likes of Pro 2, Discovery, just all kind of main ones, but definitely those couple of ones that's been on the list. And obviously Community Pro Wrestling. That's the five goals that I've wanted.
I assume England, of course, Eve would probably be quite high up on there. That would be one of your main goals there.
That was one of my main goals for like the English scene. Luckily enough, I'm breaking into England like next month. So that's one debut. And then hopefully from then on, it's one after the other.
So, I mean, you mentioned who you want to wrestle in Scotland, likes of Shea Monet, Anastasia, and Ashley Vega, and Ellie Armstrong. Is there anyone, because I noticed there's a lot of English talent coming up to ICW recently. Is there anyone that's caught your eye that you're like, yeah, but we could probably have a little bit of magic with?
So I've always looked up to Alexis Falcon. Would love to have a match for her. I think she's great. Harley Hudson as well. She's obviously coming up for Insane Championship Wrestling for her debut. Like, I've had a wee bit of, not back and forth, like, spoke to her a couple of times and watched her in matches and stuff, and she's always been great. I like Debbie Cattell as well. She's obviously from Ireland. Love to have a match for her, and Session Muff as well. But I think these are my dream ones, but I don't know. We'll see what happens. If they happen, but I would like them.
Yeah, I mean, I've got a soft spot for Alexis Falcon, mainly because she's obsessed with Disneyland, and
there's nothing wrong with
being obsessed with Disneyland.
Yeah, there's nothing. I love Disneyland as well, but sadly I'm not been yet. So
you know, that's gonna be connected. You have to.
My sister and talks of going to the one in Paris. Mm-hmm. Hopefully soon, so that'll be exciting.
It is ace fun. I went there for my honeymoon. Mm-hmm. It was just the best time ever. Mm-hmm. So yeah, definitely. I'm hoping one day. I mean, you never know nowadays. Now that I don't know if that Rumble films Disney, but if it is, I'm just hoping there's going to be some wrestling at Disney at some point.
That would be
the best thing ever. I don't know how it would work, but I'm all into finding out and going and working out from there. Mm-hmm. So when you've seen all these UK names, things like, is NXT UK something that you'd be on your bucket list, or are you kind of taking it one country at a time?
I think I'm just taking it one step at a time. Just happy to be doing what I'm doing. Obviously, as I'm kind of that person that like doesn't look ahead, tries to just look on what I'm doing just now. But NXT UK would be great. But I'm just happy to be doing what I'm doing now, and hopefully this time next year I've obviously broken to England, Ireland, and hopefully abroad as well. Love that.
Yeah, I mean, there's plenty of places. I think I'm seeing like Martina and Emerson Jane are up in Israel wrestling at the moment. Mm-hmm. And I thought that was just like kind of mind blowing, because when you think about when you watch wrestling in the country, you think that's probably, you wouldn't think that would be a possibility that you could wrestle in Israel and all that kind of stuff, and it's entirely possible. And was there anything that this really surprised you about getting into wrestling that you may not have expected? I don't know, something that maybe you find out about yourself, or just something you're like, oh, that's a thing, kind of thing.
I don't know. I just found out that I actually had a really good background of cardio. I used to think that I wasn't great at cardio, and actually I'm quite good at it. So that was one thing that I'd realised when I got into wrestling. But no, I think that was really it, to be fair. And just how high I can flip. Didn't realise that either.
Excellent. So we do have a couple of silly questions. Now, you'll see a couple of episodes, you'll know what they are. So I'll just get them in, and you can either give me a long explanation or just tell me outright. What would win the fight, two sheep or one cow?
I want to say the one cow. Okay. I think because it's bigger.
Fair, that's fair. It's again, it's an open question to interpretation, even though everyone that says one cow is wrong, in my opinion. But, you know, that's just the way it is. Another question that we ask everyone is, what's your favourite dinosaur?
I think I see the T-Rex.
Nice, simple. Fine, cool. Nice and a classic. So back to the wrestling then. So for me, when I watch wrestling, I use it as a comforter. I suppose for yourself, now you use it as that and also as a learning tool.
Yeah.
But is there any matches in particular that you go back to, like ones that you watch multiple times? Because I was speaking to someone yesterday and I was realizing that it was Jeff Hardy Undertaker Raw 2002 ladder match. That's my comfort film match. So is there any matches that you're like, right, I'm having a crap day, I'm going to watch this particular match?
So I always watch the Evolution. So I'd watch from start to finish on Evolution. I always watch like Melina and Mickey. And I think it's Melina takes the belt off her. I'm not sure what year it is, but every time I like watch that, like I'm hooked. But I also kind of watch the Women's Royal Rumbles. Like I'm hooked with them. I love them. That's mostly what I would watch if I wanted a comfort or if I wanted a learning curve. But recently I've been trying to watch a lot more AEW, like the women's division. And obviously because Britt's in it, like that's another thing I can watch her and enjoy her, and then I can watch for a learning curve.
For someone that's so flexible then, because of course your experience and you're watching Melina matches, is there any points where you see, because I know that like during Beth Phoenix matches, Melina would end up kicking herself in the head. Pretty much that would be how the matches work out for her. Is there any point where you're, like, you try to downplay your flexibility so you don't have to do that? Is there any point that?
Like, that's the thing, like in training I'm just like, just bend me, like I just love being flexible, like I like it. So I'm just, whenever I'm in training I'm just like, yeah, we can do this move, and then they're just like, no, that's going to hurt you, and I'm just like, no, it's not. But yeah, I just try and like, and when I'm in training I'm just like, can we do flexible stuff today? But not a lot of the guys are like that flexible. They're just like, no.
So we kind of spoke about your first match and what you've got coming up, and we kind of spoke about what you want to do as well. But one question that we ask people, we'll probably get to other stuff in a second as well, but I tried to end the show on one question, but we'll just do it now because, you know, it's my show. Vince McMahon phones you. It's similar to the Alan's question, but he's given you the main event in WrestleMania and he's letting you choose your match, so you can choose however many opponents you want. Doesn't matter who they are, you get to pick. So it could be a triple threat, it could be a singles, it could be a rumble. What would it be and what would the stipulation be?
So I think I would go for a freebie, and I think I would have Melina in it, and I would also have Naomi. So that's kind of Alan's question.
Find the loophole. And
yeah, I think Naomi is amazing. I think she's entertaining. Just everything about her, all of her, and obviously Melina, like she was the first person that I idolized. So I think I would have that match, or I would have a singles with Kaylee, Alba Fire. I think that's the two dream matches that I would love. And if someone phoned me up, I would be like, yep, this is a match.
And there'd probably be a pocket of people in Glasgow just going, oh, it's like two doinks, just the mirror.
Yeah, it's mirror. Like once.
You could be your stunt double. You could be the old Damien Sandow. Possibilities are endless. So for someone like I say, you've talked about your mental health and how you've really battled to get past that intake and become Nicole Jasmin, and you've done it. It took a little bit longer than you possibly hoped, but you've done it. And of course, the pandemic didn't get in the way as well. You made it. If there's any advice you could give, say anyone, male or female, that maybe has that kind of struggle or thinks they might not be able to get past these troubles and intakes and what have you, is there any advice you'd give them?
I would just say, don't listen to anyone else. For me personally, I've always been a people pleaser. I've always tried to please people. But for my mental health sake, it's not happening. Like, you only get one of you. Try and focus on yourself. These days don't last forever. It does get better. And obviously it's easier at the time saying that, but it does get better, and I've learned that through the years. And if anyone ever wants to speak to me, I'm always a message away. Like, I don't mind helping out people, even if they want to speak to me in private. Like, I'm always here. Like, I'm very open about mental health, and I'll always, if it helps you, then it's helped me.
So before we go then, we've talked about your goals, we've talked about where you want to get to, but have you got like any know how they got like side quest goals. So ones that might possibly not your big ones, but just little ones that you'd love to do. Like, I don't know, wrestle a death match. You know, something a bit, you don't need to hit it, but if you do, that'd be a nice little bonus. Okay. Have you got any on that bucket list?
I think I would love to wrestle a hardcore match, not like a death match, but like I would like to do like tables, chairs, candlesticks. Love that. That's always been a thing. And I think I used to get called from Alan and Quack deathmatch dash round because I love death matches, but then I'm like, I also love dash rounds, so they incorporated that together and that's what I've been called since. But I think I'd love to do a hardcore match or a ladder match or a gauntlet again. I really enjoyed it, but that's what I've always been thinking of, the wee side things.
Sorry, this is kind of took a sidebar then, because we started, you were a girly girl, and you got into wrestling and all that kind of stuff. And then we suddenly took a 180 there into death matches. So what is it about death matches?
I've just always liked them. I think before I'd watched some, didn't watch like pay-per-views or anything, just watched wee clips online. And I'd watch, I'm not too sure who the guys were at the time, but just watching them do it was really good. And then I watched obviously the Cubans of Insanity match at ICW and I was hooked into them. But I don't think I would want to do like deathmatch wrestling. I think I'd want to do the hardcore match and just not bleed or anything, just tables, candlesticks, chairs, like that kind of stuff. But I don't think my sister and my family would be happy if they see me getting hit. They're quite supportive like that. They're just like, you can wrestle, but try and not get hurt.
A couple of bruises is okay, but I'd rather not be stitching anything up at the end of it.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so a hardcore match on the horizon. I suppose I'm trying to think of like, I've been seeing the likes of Lexi Lux as well up, out in Europe. She's doing quite a lot of that more deathmatch style, but still kind of a bit hardcore and all that kind of thing. So there's definitely a place for it. So who knows, maybe you'll be in Sweden battering Lexi at some point.
Yeah, hopefully that'd be there.
So I think we've pretty much we've covered everything wrestling wise. I don't know if there's anything you're expecting me to bring up. You said you had your notes and everything. We've kind of
covered. To be fair, my notes were just all like my journey and just where I'd like to wrestle. But yeah,
covered it fine.
Been great chatting to you today.
Excellent. Thank you very much. So where can people find you? Actually, before we do that, Nicole Jasmin, was there any particular name behind the name, or was it just the one you liked?
The Jasmin part is a name that I wanted to be called when I was younger. Like, I never ever wanted my own name. I was like, no, I want Jasmin. And then Nicole just randomly came along, so I just kind of merged it together and got Nicole Jasmin.
Excellent. Well, that was a terrible question by me to end on, but where can people find out more about Nicole Jasmin if they want to find out more, or contact you or ask you any questions?
So you can find me on Twitter at NicoleJasmin1_. Also the same for Instagram, NicoleJasmin1_. And also have an email on my Twitter. So if you ever want to hit me up with bookings or interviews, then feel free.
Excellent. Perfect. Well, thank you very much for joining me today.
Thank you for having me.